Good afternoon and welcome to the Bardo Arts Center at Western Carolina University's virtual programming. I'm Denise Drury-Homewood, director of the Bardo Arts Center, and I'm so glad that you could join us today for one of several virtual public programs that are happening each Thursday in April. We've transitioned many of our public programs to virtual live platforms with the goal of engaging our community while we're all staying at home to keep our community safe from COVID-19. Today's talk centers around one of the WCU Fine Art Museum's spring exhibitions, Curious Terrain, WNC From the Air, featuring stunning aerial photographs of the WNC region by Alex S. Maclean. Today's discussion will be facilitated by WCU Fine Art Museum Curator of Collections and Exhibitions, Carolyn Grosch, and include guest speakers, Alex Maclean and Jim Costa, Executive Director of the Highlands Biological Station. At about 12:30, we'll open it up to questions from our audience watching on Facebook and YouTube. Please post your questions in the comment section and we'll get to as many as we can throughout the presentation. Before I turn it over to Carolyn, I want to thank a few people who are making this event possible behind the scenes. Sam Wallace, WCU's Director of Photography and Videography Services, who is facilitating the video feed. Riley Rockmore, WCU's Social Media and Digital Content Strategist. And Bardo Art Center's own Jill Jacobs, who is behind the scenes fielding your questions on social media. I also want to recognize the Community Foundation of Western North Carolina for their generous grant funding, which is helping to realize the exhibition and public program and will help us travel the exhibition to our partner, the Bascom Center for the Visual Arts in Highlands, North Carolina this fall. So with that, I'll turn it over to Carolyn Grosch, who will introduce today's speakers.
Thanks, Denise. I'm Carolyn Grosch. I'm the curator of collections and exhibitions at the WCU Fine Art Museum. And the Curious Terrain exhibition, which we'll be talking about today, really explores the relationship between human beings and the WNC landscape. The exhibition was developed in conjunction with our campus theme this year of environment and sustainability. And it started as an effort to understand how environmental issues involving land use play out on a local level. So thinking about our built environment in Western North Carolina, what we were interested in finding out was what aspects of our region's built environment reflect wider trends across the United States. And on the flip side of that, what is specific to our topography and history here in Western North Carolina? In other words, what is unique about our region in terms of how we use and impact the land? So to answer these questions, the Fine Art Museum undertook an incredible project to commission Alex S. Maclean, a renowned aerial photographer, to come to Western North Carolina and take images of the 7 westernmost counties of the state from an airplane. Alex visited 3 times in September, October, and December of 2019, taking over 2,000 photographs of the region from the air. And the curatorial team miraculously whittled this down to 28 images, which are featured in the exhibition. They capture a range of subject matter from mountaintop houses and farm buildings to solar panels and landfills, as well as a number of sites in Western North Carolina, including Santee-La Dam, downtown Highlands, and the world's largest 10 commandments. The images encourage us to think more deeply about our impact on the land in Western North Carolina, giving us a completely new perspective, as well as the land's impact on us. So to talk to us today about the images in the exhibition, we have our exhibiting artist, Alex Maclean, who is an artist and pilot with over 45 years of experience photographing the land from the bird's eye perspective of an airplane. He earned his Master of Architecture degree from the Harvard Graduate School of Design in 1973 and his pilot license in 1975. He's exhibited his work internationally and has published numerous books about the physical and cultural aspects of the landscape. He's especially interested in how aerial photography can foster a deeper understanding of the built environment by revealing patterns in the land and shedding light on environmental issues and non-sustainable human behaviors. His photographs can be found in the collections of the De Cordova Sculpture Park and Museum in Massachusetts, the Pompidou Center in France, Dartmouth University's Hood Museum of Art, and the Peabody Essex Museum, which is where I first saw Alex's photographs in 2005. The WCU Fine Art Museum is very excited to be adding the 28 images from the Curious Terrain exhibition to its own permanent collection of artwork. Also with us today is Jim Costa, the executive director of the Highlands Biological Station and a professor of evolutionary biology at Western Carolina University. His interests include environmental history and philosophy, insect behavior and ecology, conservation biology, and history of science. His research has focused in recent years on Charles Darwin and the history of evolutionary thought. He's authored numerous research papers, reviews, articles, and 7 books, including his most recent publication, Darwin's Backyard: How Small Experiments Led to a Big Theory. And Jim is here to give us a scientific perspective on aerial photographs and to share his thoughts on what they reveal about humans and the land in Western North Carolina. So Alex, I'm going to turn it over to you to first tell us about your work as an aerial photographer and your thoughts on the Curious Terrain project.
Thanks, Caroline. This is a great project for me. It's exciting because it was an area that I hadn't been to really spend any time covering, and it was in part because of the terrain itself being hilly. It's not really hospitable to flying and looking around, and so it was new for me that way, just from the logistics of flying. To the left is a typical, actually one of my early planes that I photographed from down in Texas, in the back country there, and it's a high wing plane. I photographed out of the left seat with lenses from about 24 millimeters out to 300 millimeters. You basically either photograph looking forward between the propeller and the strut or to the back. If I want to take vertical pictures, I just bank the plane and I'm looking straight down. So everything I shoot is really handheld, 35 millimeter format cameras. I changed to digital in 2004. I was a fellow at the American Academy of Rome. And at the time, that was part of my project. Besides shooting the Italian urban edge, I was looking into transitioning from film to digital. That was actually rather hard until an artist told me that I couldn't find, you know, the compromise between the two, because digital wouldn't do what film would do, and film obviously can't do what digital does. So one of the artists said, "Oh no, it's one or the other. You know, it's like paint is like oils and watercolor. They're two different mediums." And that was really a breakthrough for me to just, you know, be able to let go of the other medium when you're dealing with one or the other. But digital turned out to be great. By 2002, I was with the newer cameras, I was shooting completely digital. And I have to say, I don't think I've taken a frame of film since then. One of the things about digital is just all the information that goes with the film. This was a follow-up plane when really climate became an issue for one of my new books on climate change, looking at land use patterns around the country that are just so carbon intense. I decided I really needed a fuel efficient plane that was a fiber carbon plane, very light and fuel efficient, which was great to shoot out of because it didn't have a strut. And then let's see, we can go to the next slide. This is just looking at some of the new technology with digital, using Lightroom, just being able to edit so quickly. As Lightroom implies, you're no longer in the darkroom and you have various modules to be able to look and develop your images, not only to organize them, but also to adjust and change them. And along with this comes a lot of information which you never had before with film, is specifically the altitude, your GPS, you know exactly where the image was taken. So this is just one of the shots in the exhibit showing the contrast of a strawberry field along a river creek. I'll go to the next slide. And as I was saying, you can just click on the metadata and go right to the map location where the image is. And from that, from the map, you can actually look up and see who's in the area. If you have questions, you can just get on the phone and ask them, you know, what's going on across the street from you or things like that, and have a nice conversation. So it's incredible way of doing research. I used to keep volumes of maps in the days before digital, when you had this, just to, you know, try to figure out where your pictures were actually taken. And so in covering such a big area, it's just such an amazing tool to actually know exactly where you are and where the picture was taken. Go to the next image. That's just the detail there. You can sort of see some of the farmers taking up the mesh. But also in this photograph, it's also about the closeness and the proximity to the stream. And one of the problems in the region is water pollution from agricultural runoff. And you sort of have that you can see that transition. Next picture. Now, one of the things that's really interesting, I find, with photography as opposed to the written word, is so much of the information is sort of subliminal. It's not directly fed to you, and you sense it, and you feel like there's something going on. But you don't necessarily quite get it at first. And the other thing that I found with photography is that if you can incorporate time into the, a sense of time into the image, whether it's geologic time or rather time at the moment. And one of the ways that time gets incorporated into a photograph is through motion, because that actually takes place over time. So here, what gives you a sense of time is the drift of the sand that's been washed off the islands here across the parking lot. And it's also kind of a nice idea that, you know, as perfect as this parking lot was, new parking lot to a store was laid out, that they really hadn't they don't have it completely nailed down with this drift across there. And then also the drift happened over a period of time. So you get that sense. And again, that's sort of the subliminal part of the image. You feel it, but you don't quite, you know, get it at first, or often you don't. I'll look at the next slide. Here is a beautiful farmstead that is obviously going through a transition. It's still in use, but it's deteriorated over time. And then one of the keys to this photograph, I don't know if you can see it on the screen, but there are high tension lines going across the bottom lower corner, which really speaks of a major transition that happened during the course of this farm, because obviously the farmer didn't build his barns under high tension wire. So it's just, it's sort of a subtle thing, but it speaks to the transition that's happening on this landscape, both by the deterioration and by that. Another image here is a parking lot, and if you look carefully, you'll see these tire skid marks where obviously someone's come out and done wheelies and left his rubber on the parking lot. But it speaks to the culture, and you know, you sort of in your background, you wonder what was happening. And so it's again one of the sort of the subtle things in the photographs that catches your imagination, and then you have to wonder about who the parking lot serves and how it's laid out with the striping. Next. So with the digital images, one of the things about it is, coming from a traditional film background, what you saw was really pretty much what you got until you got into the darkroom and could manipulate it. But that was actually pretty difficult, especially with color film going from slides. It wasn't until you made a print, and it wasn't the transparency that got changed. But with digital imaging, one of the amazing things is you can use haze filters in the post-production of actually taking the image, so you can see how you can adjust this image. For me now, as an artist or an aerial photographer, I find there are almost twice as many days that are really productive for photography, whereas in film, you just really, these adjustments were impossible to make. So it was one of the nicer transitions for me going to digital. I think there's a couple more images here, maybe. No, is that the last image? Oh, okay. I sent another file after. That's fine. But
thanks for telling us a little bit more about your images. It's great to hear you talk about it.
Yeah,
I'm curious because we have Jim here too, and it'll be interesting to hear his scientific perspective on these photographs. So, Jim, I'm going to turn it over to you so you can tell us a little bit about your thoughts.
Okay, sure. Yeah, thanks so much, Carolyn and Denise. I really appreciate the invitation to be part of this. It's been a pleasure and an honor, really, to get to ruminate on Alex's photographs. And, you know, kind of taking off on something he just mentioned about time, you know, I got to thinking about these photographs as I had a lot of fun musing over them and thinking about our landscape here as a kind of anthroposcape. You know, we live in the Anthropocene period, a period of unprecedented human impacts on the landscape. And I got to thinking about this, our immediate landscape as a kind of, as an anthroposcape, and how these images kind of reflect these various ways in which we've interacted with the landscape over the years. If I can have the next slide, please. I was struck by something that Alex had mentioned. One of his interests is in what he called human intervention and natural processes. And I was sort of musing on that and how human interventions with the natural world have, certainly they've always been there, but they've increased dramatically, you know, in diversity and magnitude at an accelerating rate over the last couple of centuries, certainly the last 50 years, this great acceleration. And that's manifested in the various ways in which we're sort of interacting with this landscape. If I can have the next slide. You know, a scene like this, this is not one of Alex's slides, but an image like this that at this scale kind of gives you a sense of a timelessness, to kind of go back to that word time that Alex had used. And then the idea that interventions past can be read in the landscape. The landscape can be read like a book. You know, there are layers of history. And I think Alex's photographs so wonderfully kind of capture these snapshots of this mosaic anthroposcape that we have. This a scene like this at this scale, the timeless quality, it may be the kind of scene that you could have beheld several centuries ago had you traveled in these mountains. If I could have the next slide, you know, with scenes like this that inspired the likes of William Bartram, for example, who explored Western North Carolina in the 1770s and was really moved by scenes like this, you know, beholding with rapture and astonishment this sublimely awful scene, he said, you know, we live in a world of mountains piled upon mountains. And at this scale, it looks timeless, like it's exactly the scene that Bartram would have seen. But then if you begin to zoom in, you begin to see the mosaic element of this landscape. And one of Alex's photographs that really struck me was this beautiful image of Nicosi Mound over in Franklin. And here you have a kind of vestige of landscapes past. You know, Bartram passed by, commented on in his famous travels of, from 1791 on Nicosi Town. And you can see this vestige, you know, the mound itself, maybe half of its original height, on top of which a council house once stood, surrounded by dwellings and gardens and farms, you know, a thriving small Indian town, Cherokee town, that now is, we're seeing a kind of vestige of that time. Here it is in this image, strikingly surrounded by development, you know, by the modern world intruding on that ancient world. If I could have the next slide. That put me in a mind of another of Alex's images. This image, I believe it was taken over near Canton. And it reminded me of the great pyramidal platform mounds of the Plains States. It sort of reminded me of a latter-day Cahokia. You know, the Cahokia site in Illinois is, you know, the greatest development of the mound culture in North America, you know, certainly the biggest mound complex north of Mexico. And here, this looks like a great pyramidal platform mound. And it's sort of, you know, obviously this is modern, it is not ancient, but it sort of evokes that image of the way in which humans have this impulse to build and impose themselves upon the landscape. Next image, please. You know, if you reflect too on how very different this landscape is, Alex's photographs represent a snapshot in time now, but this landscape 100, 120 years ago was radically different. The most obvious difference would have been that it was virtually denuded of trees, right? Industrial scale logging had stripped this landscape of most of its trees. And this image from Alex really, you know, kind of evoked that image to me. Here we have a mountainside stripped of its trees. And yet, I thought it was, you know, in a way, a kind of irony, maybe a cruel irony, that the logging roads here seem to themselves trace out a tree on this mountainside. So certainly the landscape doesn't look like this anymore, right? Thank goodness. Next image, please. If you look at some of Alex's other images, a bit like the one that I used to invoke Bartram, you get a sense of the timelessness, right? This scale. Certainly in the foreground, you see some human, you know, intrusion, you know, but then in the background, you begin to see, you know, just, you know, this mountains piled upon mountains. But at the same time, if you look closely, you begin to see evidence of human imposition. You can trace lines that go way, even in the upper right-hand corner of this image, you'll see a very sizable power line cut. So you see how humans have inserted themselves in subtle and not so subtle ways into this landscape. Next image, please. So, you know, in thinking about Alex's images, you know, I think that they are, in thinking about human interventions, those interventions to me are most obvious in images that are illustrating boundaries and patterns. Those are some of the most beautiful and striking images. If I can have the next slide. These, for example, you know, representing these very striking and beautiful boundaries between agricultural areas and natural or semi-natural areas. The colors, the textures, you know, the very abrupt transition, those really just speak volumes about, you know, that there's a human presence, but an even greater human presence is obvious in the next slide, which is Alex's images that illustrate patterns. I mean, striking visually, patterns that really speak to a human presence, you know, making, you know, these parallel stripes and these geometrical patterns that are wholly unnatural, right? They're just not found in nature. So this is one of the ways in which humans are reworking the landscape, and they show evidence of their presence. Next slide, please. And so this, you know, gets me thinking about scale, you know, scale. If you think about it, the earliest patterns of settlement were really restricted to the valleys and along rivers and creeks, right? The rivers were the highways. They were a water source, a food source. You know, but technology is what has freed us from the contours of the landscape and the necessity of being proximate to a water source, right? It's the technology over time that has enabled us to literally move mountains, hold back the rivers, impose ourselves almost anywhere in this landscape. And I'll explore that just a little bit here to return to this image, you know, this, in the one hand, looking to me like a great, you know, platform mound going up. Are we creating a mountain here? Or are we destroying a mountain, right? Either way, it speaks to our technology, the power we have to literally move mountains. Similarly, in the next slide, some of Alex's images capture some of the great lakes of this region. Wholly unnatural, right? We're forcing lakes in a landscape where they simply shouldn't exist. They didn't exist before technology permitted building monumental dams like Santitla, which you see here in the lower left. And they create, by flooding great gorges and valleys, these epic scale lakes. This is an image of, I believe, Lake Hiwassee. And you get, I call this Southern Appalachian fjords. You get a sense of these wooded ridges that are separated by deep mountain slopes that are now underwater. And the unnaturalness of these lakes is betrayed by the fact that you get this sterile bathtub ring-like effect, the brown zone that you see surrounding the vegetation, which is caused by the TVA's annual lowering of the lake level to get ready for winter rains, right? So again, forcing ourselves in a landscape. And finally, in that regard, you know, here's a beautiful image of, this is near Whiteside Mountain, near Highlands. We have this fabulous pluton of Whiteside Mountain, the Blue Ridge Escarpment, half a billion year old rock. And here we have houses perched atop this pluton. Again, the technology, 100 years ago, 120 years ago, it would have been very, very impractical to live in such a place. But technology is what permits drilling, for example, deeply enough in this rock to get water to make it possible to live there or deal with sewer or septic issues and those sorts of things. So as we think about layers of history on the landscape, we see how the varied ways in which our technology has freed us to do almost anything we want. But Alex's images also preserve kind of these vestiges of history. He showed this image. This is a kind of monument of farming past. And as he said, though, you see the high tension lines kind of cutting through this image. And I was really struck by the juxtaposition of this image with the next one, which I think of as farming present, right? So here we have an interesting case of, you know, a site that may have been farmed, in which case we were harvesting plants that were harvesting sunlight. Maybe it became a pasture, in which case we were harvesting animals that were harvesting the plants that were harvesting the sunlight. Now this technology permits us to just harvest light, you know, and it creates these fascinating solar farms on the landscape that never existed before. Next slide, please. So a couple final thoughts here. Even as humans and human interventions, as Alex had put it, increase at this ever accelerating pace, I got to thinking too that our interventions to our interventions have also increased. Think about our national parks, our wilderness areas, national forests, other conserved lands. I think of as sort of an archipelago of natural areas in this anthroposcape. And it speaks to coexistence, the importance of enlightened coexistence. And I'm gonna leave the last word here with Thoreau, and this is in Alex's honor because he hails from Thoreau country up there in Massachusetts. Thoreau, he certainly advocated for enlightened coexistence. And so we find in essays like Walking from 1862, the year of his death, that yes, you know, we humans are inhabitants, we're part and parcel of nature. That is certainly true, but we shouldn't forget that in wildness is the preservation of the world. And finally, too, this put me in a mind of Thoreau's thinking about beauty in the landscape and our ability to perceive and interact with that. As I quote here from his journal, right, there's just as much beauty visible to us in the landscape as we are prepared to appreciate. But what I would add to that, you know, thinking about Alex's images and this mosaic anthroposcape, I would add that there's just as much beauty visible to us in our landscape as we are prepared to allow. And so with that, I want to just thank you very much.
Thanks, Jim. Thanks. We really appreciate your thoughts. So we have a question coming in from the public. This is from Rachel Gibby. And I'm going to turn this over to Alex. Rachel asks, what did you see in Western North Carolina that you haven't seen in other places?
Oh, geez. That's a good question. I came away saying, I've never seen anything like this in the U.S. It was a completely sort of unique, in part because of the topography of the hills and the valleys and the, as Jim was mentioning, the settlement areas, the early settlement areas were all in the valleys. So minimal agriculture, they do see strips along some of the rivers, small. And the other thing, some of the things that I saw that were different, or actually, unfortunately, not that different, was income disparity between very wealthy homes up on the hillside that Jim pointed out with one slide to others in the valleys of trailer parks. And just obviously, there's a great wealth disparity. You saw the production of pollution, as Jim pointed out, in that landfill, huge landfill going right next to a river, and just, you know, being able to control this type of waste. And then you just saw such pockets of beauty. That one image of the cattle in the field in front of the forest. And there's just, you know, around every corner, there was something that was really quite gorgeous and worth photographing. And then for me, the other thing that was unique was just the flying was unique. It's quite different flying in mountainous areas with wind currents and the weather patterns being different. And for me, not being that experienced, it, you know, took a little precautions and getting used to. But it was a, you know, a terrific, you know, I really have to thank you for bringing me there. It was a terrific three visits to the area and photographing.
Yeah, we were really happy to have you here. And I thought that was a really fascinating part of the project, was to hear you sort of respond to our region.
Yeah.
And, you know, in terms of what maybe you hadn't seen in other places, you know, what was specific to our region. And actually, Jim, your comment about Niquassee Mound, I think is really significant too, because, you know, it's sort of, you know, reading these vestiges of landscapes past, but it also points to this, you know, the importance of Cherokee culture in this region and sort of the vibrant Cherokee culture that still exists, which I think is, you know, something you don't find in every place in the United States. It's something you need to hear. So,
the importance of honoring that and preserving these important sites. Yeah, thank goodness there's, you know, tremendous interest in doing that now, more so than ever, I think.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So, Alex, we have an interesting question coming in from Yeet Fig. And they ask, have you ever seen a bear from the aerial footage?
Have I ever seen, geez, you know, I've seen a lot of animals, but I can't say as I've seen a bear. I've seen wild horses on Chincoteague and, just various wildlife and the evidence of wildlife, but I didn't see a bear.
Bears are very common sighting here in Western North Carolina. So
that's when you're glad you're in a plane.
Yes. So we have another question coming in from Sarah Rincon, and she asks, why did you title the show Curious Terrain? So I can speak to that, and Alex, maybe you have thoughts on that too, but I think for me, the title really summed up perfectly the exhibition, because when you look at Alex's photographs, you're not always entirely sure at first what you're seeing. And so it sparks this curiosity, you know, in you as a viewer, and you want to know, you know, what am I looking at, or where was this image taken? And so you immediately want to know more about what you're seeing. So in this slide, for instance, topsoil over clay, you look at this and it looks like a painting. It's amazing, this image from the air. But you get that little clue in the bottom right corner with that truck that, you know, sort of clues you into, you know, the fact that you're looking at this topsoil and these trucks that are moving materials off the site. So it really sparks your curiosity. I think the other thing about the title that was really interesting or perfect for the show was that we were interested in what sparked Alex's curiosity. So something like those clifftop houses that Jim mentioned and Alex mentioned, you know, as an aerial photographer, Alex, with over 45 years of experience, you know, we wanted to know what was curious or unusual to you. And I think that speaks to what you just, you know, commented on, what's unique to our region. Did you have any thoughts about the title, Alex? We sort of went back and forth about different titles.
Oh, we had a few titles. I always enjoyed the idea of back of beyond and the history of that. I did like Curious Landscapes because, you know, I have to say I had so many questions about some of the images that I took and, you know, what was behind them. Some of the hazardous or the landfill details as to what was going on. Again, it was really fun to be able to, as I mentioned, to be able to find local sources pretty readily by knowing where you were and getting the information off of Google Earth and being able to call people and speak to them firsthand as to what was going on. But so, yes, I had a lot of curiosity myself, you know, trying to decipher these. So I thought it was a good title. I have to give you credit for that, Caroline.
Thank you. So we have another question coming in from Jay Strum, and he asks, do you ever take aerial video when you're in the plane?
You know, I don't take aerial video. I've tried it, and the problem is with video. I suppose if the camera was mounted on the plane, I could, but I always like and holding it and the precision of what appears in the frame by hand holding it. And, you know, you really can't take your eyes off the control for more than, you know, four or five seconds or, you know, maybe 10 seconds. So video really doesn't work unless perhaps I had someone else flying the plane. But when I'm photographing, I'm pretty much setting myself up in the aircraft to, you know, fill the frame of a still camera, which I can do fairly quickly and not have to, you know, completely take away from flying the plane at the same time. It was just too much to do simultaneously.
Mm-hmm. So and, we have a, We have a question from Martin DeWitt, who is the founding director of the WCU Fine Art Museum. He's tuning in today.
Oh,
and he says, thank you, Alex, Jim, Carolyn, and Denise. Being earthbound, our level of consciousness seems to level out. When we look to the skies, we seek a broader perspective. Your beautiful photographs from above seem to expand a level of consciousness. Alex, can you speak to consciousness involving your work, the notion of consciousness, perhaps from a cultural perspective, astronauts' point of view abound? And he says, just amazing. So notion of consciousness from a cultural perspective.
Yes, I think you're, you know, it's interesting because flying, you're sort of in a medium that's sort of universal. When you're flying in other parts of the world, it's, there's such similarity, but the actual landscape below you is what's changing, and it really does reflect the local culture. I think that, you know, one of the things that's almost discouraging is when you go to different parts of the country, when you see the regionalism fall apart by this sort of land patterns that are just sort of transnational now, from housing developments, the interstate highway system is just so uniform in, you know, all parts of the country, the same sort of specifications, signage, and things like that, that you do lose that regional pattern. So, but I do like the, yeah, I do like the regional, the locality that you see looking down.
Yeah, I think those you know, regional differences and also the similarities that cut across is really
right.
Something that comes out through the work.
Well, that would be typical of that parking lot I showed. I mean, that was just out of a book that someone, you know, could pretty much lay down by the rules of how you lay out a parking lot.
Right, like textbook parking lot design.
Textbook parking lot you could find anywhere.
So we have a question from Sprigley's Beescaping, and they ask, what are some examples of non-sustainable human behaviors that are evident from the photographs? And Alex, I'm sure you have thoughts on that, and also Jim.
Well, Alex, you can go ahead first. You want to go, Jim?
No, you go ahead first.
Well, I think, yeah, so much of what you see in the way of consumerism and how we just use natural resources without really giving it too much of a thought. And on the flip side of that, you also see it through waste and how we dispose of material goods. That was the idea of, you know, I am sort of drawn to the sort of the landfills that you see. The one that Jim showed was really kind of spectacular in that it did almost have this sacred element to it, piled up as a pyramid or at the platform of sorts. But yes, I think just the amount of consumerism that we all engage in is, you know, just sort of indicative. The flip side of it is when you see practices that are obviously sustainable, is sort of the flip side of the consumerism part. A lot of new agricultural practices, smaller farms, things like that, that are regenerative, mm-hmm. are encouraging.
Yeah,
So it's it's really in the contrast.
And Jim, did you have thoughts on non-sustainable human behaviors that were evident from the photographs?
Well, one of the things that that you can always look to is look at any parking lot and see cars that are, you know, really not getting great fuel mileage, bigger than what, you know, the average suburban person needs to get back and forth. I mean, that's just a universal example you can see across the country. And when we look at carbon emissions, you know, there's very little consideration there. So you see it maybe all these different ways.
Yeah, maybe there are a number of ways I think that are pretty evident, you know, unsustainable practices that become evident in sediment plumes and maybe the unnatural greenness of some farming areas where there may be excessive use of fertilizers. But maybe the single biggest sign from the photographs of a kind of trending towards unsustainability is the simple fragmentation of this forest ecosystem, which is inevitable. And I think that some of the biggest problems that arise from that fragmentation are the least obvious in an aerial photograph. For example, all of those many corridors, the corridors of power line cuts, the corridors of highways and other roads, et cetera, they're also, they're lined by, in most cases, invasive plants, right? So these are conduits for wave upon wave of invasive species that themselves further nibble away at the edges of what's left of this kind of natural area archipelago that we have. So that's very striking that on one level, the landscape can still look fairly whole and healthy and green, but on a rather closer look, you get a sense of the fragmentation and a sense that much more of that is really not at all sustainable.
Yeah, that's a very good point.
Yeah, so Alex, we have a few questions. People interested in you know, your flying and sort of the process and all of that. So Curtis Grace asks, at what altitude above ground level does Alex find is best for his photography? And is that primarily due to the photography or for the flight safety in the mountains?
What was the last part of that, Caroline?
So they ask about the altitude that you fly at, and is that primarily for the purposes of the photography or is that for the flight safety in the mountains?
Well, it's two parts. One is over a populated area, you're really, your minimum altitude is 1,000 feet. Over unpopulated areas, you can go lower. But there is a safety factor. And one of the hard things about flying here was your minimum altitude just to be able to, if you lost power, is you want to be able to glide to a safe place to land. And when it's wooded and hilly like this, you really have to sort of exercise more precaution. My biggest problem, I generally fly between 1,000 and 1,500 feet AGL, above ground level is AGL. And I often forget to go up high and get the more regional view just because it takes time to climb up and you're so enamored by what you see low. But usually, yeah, to get more of a regional sense, you know, going up higher will give you that view. So I think high, you know, 3,000 feet above the ground gives you a pretty good expansive view. If it's a really clear day, you can go even higher and see more. You run into haze problems as you go up in altitude. And I should point out, during this pandemic, you know, be sure to look around because the air has never been clearer than it is. It is phenomenal. Here in Boston, I've had friends send me pictures of Los Angeles, and you just realize how much air pollution we put up just driving and carrying out our everyday lives.
So, yeah, that's true. We're seeing those environmental differences in this, this strange situation. We have an interesting comment from someone from the Poconos. So Lori Hill says, thank you for letting me enjoy this. The photographs are beautiful, and getting to listen to the photographer and his thoughts was very enlightening. I live in the Poconos and usually visit Western North Carolina every spring and fall, but of course not this year. And she says, hopefully she can later. So she's certainly, it sounds like, inspired by our landscape here in Western North Carolina as well.
Yeah, Poconos are beautiful too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not as big.
We have a question specifically for Jim. Patricia Cabe Cantrell asked, is there any evidence from the air that reveals that our old mountains here in Western North Carolina once looked more akin to the quote unquote young Rocky Mountains out west?
Yeah, there's no indication of that, you know, the sort of inherent in the views of the landscape. There's certainly very good geological evidence in our immediate surroundings that these mountains were once much, much, much higher. For example, you know, the Piedmont and especially the coastal plain of the Carolinas has extremely thick sediments. And those sediments were derived from the erosion of those very, very ancient mountains. You know, the Appalachian chain had geologists currently, you know, understand the current thinking is that there were multiple waves of mountain building with building and erosion, building and erosion. And in more than one of those phases, the understanding is that these mountains were, you know, very, very high, probably higher, in fact, than the Rockies and the Sierras out in Western North America.
Yeah, and actually, we have another question about erosion. Kurt Collins says, Mr. Maclean, did you notice the movement of sediment through construction, agricultural erosion in a stark way from the plain? And were you able to see it in a way that showed of time and progression? The movement of sediment.
I would say that's true. One of the areas obviously you see is in agriculture with runoff. We saw in that parking lot just evidence of erosion with the sand washing across the parking lot. That's sort of on a micro scale, but these things all add up over time. And then another image that is in the show is at the construction site with the great efforts of putting down materials to cover materials to keep erosion from happening and berms at the edge of the site. So, you know, erosion is definitely a problem anytime you have construction or disturbance of the soil. One of the new trends in agriculture now is no-till agriculture, in part to prevent erosion, but also oxidation of soils. So you definitely can see, you know, how it plays out on the landscape, especially along river channels and stream beds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we have another comment from Gary Long. He mentions the local news covering the construction runoff into the Tuckasegee River. He asked what evidence we saw of this in the aerial photography, and is there other construction and development impact that you've seen?
Well, yes, the erosion is obviously one of the most direct ones that you see, especially the site. And you see it now more so in the precautions people are taking. On the other hand, the strawberry farm that we saw, some of the runoff there was not so much erosion, but it was also runoff from fertilizers and agricultural chemicals into the river. So that's sort of invisible, but you do see the impact of that in eutrophication of lakes, which is one of the problems that interfere with recreational use there and also drinking water. In the region.
Yeah, and I think that was a strong theme in the exhibition that ended up coming through, was sort of the impact of, you know, our land use and development on our waterways. We had a few images that related to that. You mentioned the agricultural image where it was very close to the river. And then actually that image that you both talked about with the landfill in Canton, that landfill is also very close to the Pigeon River.
Oh, it's right up against it. Yeah, it's really, you know, it's shocking, shockingly close, and you just really wonder how it's really fully segregated from the watershed there, and the impact, direct impact that it would have.
Yeah. So just to, you know, kind of wrap up our session, I'm so happy that you both could join us, but maybe as a final question, Alex, what do you think that aerial photography offers us in terms of what we can learn about ourselves as human beings and how we live on the land?
Well, the most immediate thing is the scale at which you can see the landscape in these larger sort of physical relationships. And it's interesting now, just in the last 3 years, how ubiquitous aerial imaging is with drone technology, and it's really democratized the aerial perspective in that so many people can now take aerial images of their surroundings. But the big thing is that just seeing these larger spatial relationships that you might not have been fully aware of. You're able to sort of see over the hill to the next valley and see these connections, which are terrific. You know, we were just talking about runoff and pollution that way. It's a scale shift that you don't really necessarily consider on the ground. But I think one of the things about it, and with the drone photography now, I think people sort of can more easily transport themselves to consider their environment in this larger scale and what that drone or aerial view might look like. But I have to say, when I started out 40 years ago, there just really wasn't that much aerial photography that was being utilized for various purposes. I even had trouble, you know, talking with fellow architects and landscape architects into its real value to be able to not only see for themselves, but be able to explain to their, you know, clients what these relationships were like. In a very sort of easy way. And just all the information that you had, it's not just map and graphic and symbolic information. You can actually see what the sidewalk material is, you know, whether it's macadam or cement or the building materials. And so it's just a whole variety of information that's encompassed in, into the image.
Yeah, and I'll say too that, you know, the aerial photographs completely changed my experience of being up in an airplane. So just taking a commercial flight home, you know, you're looking out the window of the plane, and I feel like having spent some time with your photographs and thinking about, you know, these environmental issues and, you know, behaviors of human beings, like, It was so much more fun to be on the airplane and looking out at the land and seeing some evidence of, you know, these different things that you talk about and you capture in your photograph. So I'll encourage everybody to look more closely out the window as they take their next commercial flight, because it'll be a whole new experience.
I think they're so compelling because they give us perspectives on ourselves from a rather, you know, wholly different context. And so there's a way to appreciate scale of our presence, but also there's a certain humbling aspect to, you know, taking this God's eye view and kind of getting a sense of ourselves. What makes them so compelling is I think it is such an interesting way to explore self-awareness, you know, the awareness of people and the way that we interact with this landscape in so many varied ways.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you so much. I want to thank Alex and Jim for being here with us today. This was a really great conversation. I enjoyed bringing the two of you together. And I'm going to turn it back over to Denise to help us wrap up our program.
Thank you, Alex and Jim and Carolyn. Thank you so much for curating this beautiful exhibition for us. I also want to thank Greg McPherson, our exhibition designer, who skillfully installed the show that you saw in the short video. I also want to give a big shout out and thank you to Jasmine Hodgson. She created the video intro that you saw at the beginning of this presentation, and she's a stage and screen major here at Western Carolina University. I also want to thank those of you out there who were asking lots of questions, and I'm sorry we couldn't get to everyone's questions, but I think we had a wonderful group of questions today. So I would love to invite you to stop by next Thursday at noon for a discussion with the artists about the museum's exhibition Time and Again, Glass Works by Kit Paulson and Sarah Beth Post. We'll be back here at noon on these same channels. I also want to let you know that if you have friends that you'd like to share this presentation with, this will be available for viewing after today on YouTube. So definitely go and check that out. And finally, if you missed the in-person exhibition at the WCU Fine Art Museum, it will travel to the Bascom Center for the Visual Arts in Highlands this fall. So hopefully you'll have an opportunity to see it in person. We miss seeing you in person at the WCU Fine Art Museum and at Bardo Art Center. We hope to see you all again soon, but until then, stop by next Thursday for another webinar. Thank you again, and we'll see you soon.